Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mary Rose by Geoffrey Girard, read by Henrietta Meire. Yes, very sad, because the real theme is, if the dead were to come back, what would you do with them? Alfred Hitchcock, discussing his plans for a movie adaptation of J.M. Barrie's play, Mary Rose. 20 years before. Ghosts were here. Everyone said so, that you could hear them wailing like banshees underneath the winds and surf, or might even see one slipping between shadow and grey moonlight and the tall dark grasses, lurking just outside the protective beam of a quivering flashlight. From where the ghosts had come, no one knew for sure. He'd heard they were the spirits of unbaptized babies, or also of water sprites who instigated drownings and shipwrecks and lived beneath the island in deep underwater caves. Maybe of forsaken Nazis or pirates who'd drowned here years before and now shambled together along empty dark shorelines for eternity. Or rail-thin wraiths floating on unearthly winds, phantoms with iron claws and grotesque crimson faces dipped in their victims' blood. Or these ghosts were simply those who'd heard the island's call, those who'd chased after it and never returned again. Ronnie trudged ahead even more slowly now, straying farther away from the others, probably. Away from his father, too. The sting of the man's hand, or at least the memory of, was still fresh upon his cheek from when he'd objected to searching without his father by his side. His father, embarrassed, disappointed. Yet, Ronnie's whole life, the man had expressly said to keep away from the small island. His whole life, he'd only ever known it as a forbidden place. He'd been told its most ancient name, an evil name, a name for a land of few animals but many strange sounds and strange lights, even portals to other worlds and, yes, ghosts. The few people who ever came out here were devil worshippers and perverts, dead teenagers and, as proven again for all, foolish tourists. Tonight, however, the island was overrun with locals. 20 men, including his father and the village constable, had already combed it from one end to the other. Now, the men were dragging the small lake on its southern side, and he and a few of the other boys had been sent off together to look again through the tall grass. No longer forbidden, it seemed. Oh, how he'd jumped at the chance to join his father and help find the girl. Now he knew better. He couldn't remember how he'd gotten separated from the other two boys. That was the island did that. Not its supposed ghosts, not its brownies, fae, doonies, selkies, or river sprites. All the things various people claimed walked here. No, it was the island itself, a living thing that breathed and hungered. Or more likely, Ronnie suspected, a thing long dead that was only feigning life, yet still carried old desires, older appetites. Ronnie turned back around, thought he heard the others' voices. Only 10 minutes before, he'd been beside Aaron McDuffie and Mousy Costello, the three of them finding strength of sorts in numbers. Now there was no one there with him. His schoolmates somehow lost to the night. Each mound and hill in the distance appeared as enormous roiling waves, waves which even moved, so that it was impossible to know where the island ended and the sea began. He thought of running once more, but feared stepping into a hidden hollow, a cave never to be seen again. No different from the English girl. He wanted to cry out to the guys, call their names, call for help. But what if he wasn't truly alone? If he cried out to them, what might hear him first? Behind him, birch trees wavered dimly in the silhouette of night, like dozens of long, crooked witch fingers breaking free from the black earth, stretching to touch an even blacker sky. He'd already doubled back twice, every turn somehow taking him farther away from where he'd thought his mates had last been. The willowy moon was lost behind massive black clouds, hovering like some prehistoric god above the whole island. Watching him, watching them all, look for the girl, watching another tragedy unfold. For this was not the first time something like this had happened. There'd been other, more horrible stories than the one playing out here tonight. This time, it was an English tourist and his daughter, 6 years old, gone missing the whole day. His father and the other local men cursed the English family under their breath. It was more than customary dislike of the outsiders, though. It was something else. His father and the others didn't like being here either. old enough to not need a good slap to force them into it, but still wary.
"Best hope she's drowned,"
his father had said, and the other men agreed as if he'd said something kind. The ground was ragged and uneven suddenly, the grass giving way to rough clusters of rock. Beyond, an outcropping and short hummock. The sound of a narrow stream trickled in the darkness between. Brilliant! He could follow the stream back to the lake where his father would be, or to the shore. In either case, he had his bearings again. Ronnie struggled more carefully, hands to rock, flashlight looking for hidden crevices and jagged edges. What if he found her? Out here among the rocks, her body twisted and limp like a discarded toy doll. Would her eyes be open? Would they be glassy too, like a doll's eyes, shining in the dark? Or would they be dull and empty? Dead was dead. Last spring, he'd seen his grandpa laid flat in the casket, all waxy and frozen like a big candle wrapped in a man's suit. What if the English girl was lying there dead like that? She might be right here beside him in the dark, and he wouldn't even know it, face up in the unseen stream, swollen and blue from the cold, or worse, alive and sitting in the dark on one of the adjacent rocks, knees up to her chin, just sitting there in the dark and waiting for someone else to come along. Would she grab him, or, much worse, gently take his hand? A sound floated past him on the cool night wind, shifting across his face. He told himself it had not been the sound of a little girl. Ronnie's foot slipped. Something ripped into his ankle. Fangs? Claws? He screamed and shone his light down. It was not the sharp teeth of a Dooney or the ghost of a Nazi. It was not the claws of some dead little girl. It was only a rock. He moved quicker now, following along the lip of the stream, jogging even, now running, praying his choice led to the lake and his father and not to some mysterious cave where horrible things mostly crawled but sometimes walked. Then something winked to life, over the next hummock, glittering whatever it was. His friend's flashlights, he told himself, another searcher maybe. But the light was not one he'd ever seen before. It was too blue, almost neon, and too shifting? More like a cloud of smoke. Unnatural. He stopped. The weird light now swelled, the glow seeping over the top of the approaching hill and casting dark shadows down toward him. The rocks between mimicked dozens of tiny tombstones. The sound in the wind had pursued him and grown more specific. It had become words. Many little voices, becoming one voice. Two words, he thought. Over and over and over, clearly imagining the name he'd first learned only hours before. Getting up his guts, he started toward the light, the sound, the next mount. The stories were true. The strange lights, the witches gathering. Rows of black candles, no doubt. Surely the girl was there, being sliced open, still alive, on a stone altar before an enormous man with thick goat legs and a book with pages written in blood. Or being transformed into something by old naked women smeared in filth and prancing over their black robes. But he would. He would find her, yes, and save her from that, and be the hero of this night. And everyone would know, and they'd tell the story for 100 years about the time he'd found the missing English girl, how his father would look at him then. He could do it. He would do it. The blue glow hung, lingered, waiting for him, goading him. Penetrating, one instant promising a lover's slick caress, the next the warm protective embrace of the Virgin Mary herself. It was like someone trying to pick a lock somewhere deep inside him, fumbling for the precise combination. The next step forward was somehow more difficult, and the next after that didn't even happen. He stood, shivering in the night, alone, except for whatever was behind that hill. The whispers escalated. Then something almost like music began, high and pulsating, as if 100 tiny fingers were slowly circling the rims of 100 unseen drinking glasses. After that, whether it was some kind of will-o'-the-wisp, or spunkies, or only a lost little girl, or maybe something far, far worse, he didn't discover that night. Instead, he finally turned back and ran, and ran. Behind him, the island became still and dark again, and any screams he'd cried were lost beneath the violent break of black water against hidden shorelines. 1. For nothing is secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hid that shall not be known and come abroad. The Gospel of Luke. 1. Mary Rose had vanished. Simon scanned the room again for her, its lolling dark waves of sleeveless silk and tailored summer wool, the buzzing staff, the four-piece ensemble in the corner, half of Philly seemingly gathered tonight in this single penthouse loft. But she was no longer among them. He moved toward the terrace, hoping for the best. He should have known. Earlier she'd seemed...
Simon Blake.
One of the guys from Swain, Dunn and Crutcher stretched out a hand.
Congratulations, man. Hey, want you to meet some new friends of mine. These fine folk are in from Tenet Healthcare in Dallas.
He turned to make the introductions over something by maybe Vivaldi.
We gotta be extra nice to Simon tonight, everyone. He just won a big one against the city this week. And there are a few people in this room who, well...
The case against the housing authority, one of the women in the group asked. Mobility impairments.
That's the one.
Simon skimmed the crowd politely enough behind them, looking. Nope. Damn.
How are you all enjoying our city so far? Fabulous.
Another visiting attorney held up his drink to toast one of the truly sterling and newest highlights of Philly Realty. Its double-height ceiling, the 5,000 square feet, the floor-to-ceiling windows.
All we need is to find one of those legendary cheesesteaks before we go, and it'll be a perfect visit.
Simon smiled politely. It was a smile that did well in rooms like this, one that did even better in front of juries and judges, somehow revealing confidence and humility at the same time. If the last 5 years with the Penn Law Collaborative were any indication, there was no telling how far that smile might take him. The big lead pipe contamination lawsuit was only last year, and now this one, and up next, lead counsel on his first international case, a little something against one of the world's largest chocolate manufacturers for slave and child labour. Also, the dreaded word politics was starting to rear its ugly head for him, hinted at by more than a few people in this very room. Shudder, a path he'd never considered before, and yet...
You were on CNN a week or so ago, the first woman said. Or was it Fox and Friends?
Simon shrugged.
Is there really a difference?
They laughed.
Oh, yeah, the Swain, Dunn and Crutcher guy explained. Simon's turning into a regular national celebrity, cable news patron saint of human rights law.
Well, now,
Simon brushed his knuckles on his jacket.
I wouldn't say that. Couple of producers got my name is all. Guess they like me for some reason.
Producers tend to like good-looking men,
the woman said, arching an eyebrow playfully, perhaps hoping to make her visit east more memorable than a cheesesteak.
They should meet this guy, then.
Simon squeezed Swain, Dunn and Crutcher's shoulder.
Someone I need to speak with. Nice meeting you all.
He bowed slightly, then continued quickly to the terrace. Their discussion of him continued, he could hear in his wake. Still no sign of Mary Rose, but he'd seen Keith outside, chatting up the new local ABC news anchor. It would help to get a second pair of trusted eyes. He'd hoped it would be a good night. Most were. But too many people, damn it. And this was on him. He hadn't realized it'd be such a zoo.
Well done, Simon.
He felt the pat on the back, turned briefly to see the president of Temple University. He'd done his undergraduate work there, even been co-captain of the wrestling team. His accomplishment since had not gone unnoticed by the school.
Thank you, ma'am.
Simon saluted, made a mental note to follow up with her later, but pressed ahead. Outside, the heavily fern terrace overlooked the Schuylkill River from 10 stories up. Beyond, the lights of southwest Philadelphia, home more than 10 years ago, though it seemed like 100 years from there to here, a whole lot of hustle and luck, and yes, smiles between.
There he is!
Keith reached up to tap Simon's arm.
Fucking Robin Hood! Yeah, that's me.
Simon checked the terrace. More nope. Hey, Keith. But Keith had turned to the news anchor.
This is the guy who made $50 million for the disabled homeless this week.
I saw that, she said. That's very cool.
Hope so. Could be. Simon looked at Keith. Not an insurance thing, so the city will need to find real money somewhere. Just means someone else, someone who probably needs it as much, will get screwed instead.
Keith laughed.
Simon's always a ray of sunshine. Where's Meire, huh? She's the fun one. As a matter of fact, I was hoping you'd seen her.
Keith shook his head, laughter closing down, though his smile remained easy.
Everything okay?
He'd gotten serious quickly, a genuine friend who Simon had confided in before, the only one who knew about Meire Rose, about her bad days.
No, no. Simon shook off his friend's concern. Everything's good.
Was it? Simon finished the drink he'd been nursing.
Thanks.
Keith nodded. Changed gears again.
The danger of dating a truly beautiful woman.
He lifted his hand to include the anchor.
Probably stolen by a troll or something.
Happens all the time. She agreed. Keith winked at her, turned back to Simon.
So, when's the engagement?
Subtle. You're in a merry mood tonight, pal.
Merry? Merry? See what you did there?
His friend made stupid faces at the newsgirl, easing the moment even more. He was good at it.
He's had the damned ring for months.
As a matter of fact, Simon waved for him to stop. In 2 weeks, we're traveling to her parents' home in England. Place called Alderley Edge.
Oh my God! Keith blinked. You're asking their permission?
We're visiting her parents. Who knows what'll happen?
I think it's sweet, the anchor offered.
Thank you.
Simon bowed his head.
To Simon!
Keith held up his glass.
Who wants to change the world, but still loves old-ass traditions.
Only the good ones, Simon countered. But all of that won't matter if she's fled the country. Or something about a troll. I'm going to make another round of the apartment.
Try not to get lost. The anchor laughed.
No kidding. Keith?
His friend had casually pulled out his phone and waved it at him, letting Simon know he'd text if he found her. That Keith carried a little crush for Meire Rose wouldn't hurt. Simon lifted his hand in goodbye and thanks, then grinned at the woman.
Take care of him for me, will you?
Maybe. The news reporter winked coyly. Simon ditched his empty glass with a passing waiter, dodged back through the room, offered several more quick hellos, and pressed on to the two bathrooms. Still nothing. He stepped out into the hallway, nodded at the couple commiserating there together, thought briefly of asking if they'd seen her pass, but kept his head down and walked past the elevator and down to the steps. He opened the door. The stairwell within was dark, only two small emergency lights glowing above the door and in the corner of the landing below.
Meire Rose?
He called down into the darkness. He could picture her sitting there below, knees up, arms pulled tightly around them, wrapped in silence and shadow.
Meire?
Simon stepped into the stairwell, bent to wedge his pen at the bottom of the door in case it was one of those that locked. Maybe she'd come here for some peace and quiet, gotten locked out and had had to make her way all the way down 10 stories in the dark to get out. Maybe even now she was on her way back on the elevator. He checked his cell. Nothing from Keith. Or her. Simon took the next few steps. Sounds from the party above filtered down, deep-toned and otherworldly.
Meire Rose?
He kept his voice kind, soft. Didn't want to startle her if she was down here. Didn't want to appear angry. She always blamed herself so harshly after one of her incidents. Consumed with guilt that she'd somehow ruined everything again. Hell, the days after times like this, when she was quietly beating herself up, always seemed more trying than the actual freakouts. Simon turned the corner and took the next row of stairs down to the 9th floor. Chilly air lifted from the darkness and floors far below traced gently across his face. The glow of faint light appeared. Here, the door gaped open, propped open with some workman's bucket of plaster. Done earlier today, or minutes before, he couldn't say. He pushed past it and stepped into the 9th floor. They were still doing construction,
scaffolding everywhere, neat stacks of drywall and sheetrock, half shrouded in tarps, the frames of two separate condos, clearly marked with poly sheeting, some plastic sheeting fluttered gently in unfelt wind, blue light cast from the window at the end of the hall, framed in original century-old brick. The building, an old textile shop in the 1860s, then a woman's shelter from the 1940s until about 2008, was now getting the full gentrification treatment, condos for multimillionaires. Simon knew the woman's shelter had moved another 20 miles upriver, had actually studied the legal proceedings that had led to the land grab, knew he'd have lost the case also, but at least given them better odds. He lay his arm against the fluttering sheet and pushed it aside.
Mary Rose?
The sound, her name, vanished into the dark, half-formed rooms within. Simon stepped past the sheeting and followed it. The whole apartment was lustrous, with the unique colours and shadow of night, like something Mary Rose would have shown him from Picasso's Blue Period, the enormous windows opening to the moonlight, and light escaping from the party above. She stood, silhouetted at the windows looking out into the night, or perhaps the ghost of her own reflection. The first time he'd found her this way, they'd been staying at a bed and breakfast down in Maryland, St. Michael's, and there he'd woken to find her perched at the end of the bed, kneeling back on her heels, staring at the mirror opposite the bed. She'd been naked and strangely vibrant in the darkness, as if born to the shadows. He'd watched her, and if she'd known he was observing her or even still in the room, she gave no notice. Finally, he'd called to her, and she'd slowly turned to look back at him. Then she'd appeared like some kind of vampire, he supposed, or perhaps something out of Greek mythology. In either case, a creature who'd walked the earth 1,000 years before man, made from the night. Feral, dangerous. He'd seen her sad and quiet, sure, seen her go to a place he tenderly dubbed October Country, but never before this way. Her shoulders, the black hair down her back, the curve of her hips, her bare ass settled tight against her legs, and those eyes looking back at him, eyes that glistened like the mirror looming behind her. It had been a side of her he'd never seen, would only barely glimpse another half dozen times over the next 2 years. Mostly, it was diluted times like this, sneaking off for some alone time in a dark room. And from the day they'd met, he'd always wanted to care for her, protect her. But that night, he only wanted to possess her, or maybe be possessed by her. And he'd crossed the bed to her, and they'd made love, and it had been being with an entirely different woman. If he were honest, it was the night he'd first decided to marry her. What, he wondered, breathing deeply, would her eyes show when she turned to night?
Excuse me, ma'am.
He spoke gently.
We've received reports of a burglar in the neighborhood.
Is that so? Mary Rose's voice was soft, throaty, her typically restrained English accent, somehow always more pronounced when she spoke so hushed. Her shoulders were bare, taut, slim marble in the moonlight.
Any leads, officer? Something about a spectacular ass.
She snorted a faint laugh.
I think I should call my attorney. Perfect. I'm your attorney. A man of many hats, it seems.
He slid his arms around her waist, pressed up against her back. Her hair smelled like honeysuckle tonight and tickled his chin. She'd surrendered against his weight, seeming to dance for all that she was standing still.
I'd like to wear one more, he said.
Maybe some jasmine, too, he decided. He'd gotten better at learning her relentless array of sprays and lotions, coconut and tropical spices, violet and jasmine, frankincense, patchouli, cinnamon and, of course, rose. Her favourite, he knew, however, was a combination of vanilla and sandalwood. He looked at her face in the window's reflection. So, she had been looking at herself again. Her gaze finally lifted to meet his, her expression breathtakingly refined, like a spring flower opened too early, dismayed the rains could be so bitter, yet still lifting its face defiantly toward the sun. Her wide eyes weren't glaring like something untamed, either. They were simply terribly resigned, almost regal.
Oh, Simon.
She'd grown rigid in his arms. I'm so sorry.
For what?
I ruined your party. He turned her to see her real face.
First, you haven't ruined anything.
His hand caressed her chin.
Second, it's not my party. It's just some people I know. You're my party. Got it?
In reply, she rested her head against his chest.
You okay?
I am indeed, she said.
Needed a break?
Apparently. She blew out an angry breath. I was thinking about England too much, I guess. About my parents.
I can imagine. My mom, I get anxious when I have to call her.
A chuckle was soft, reassuring. Silly Simon.
You still want to do the trip?
I should. It's been 6, 7 years. They've always come here.
Look, if it's...
No, I'm fine. She smiled then. That smile that worked even better than his, for all she wasn't trying. It's just what I was thinking about. I suspect it had more to do with all those people. So many. He felt her breathing deeply against him. They stood together a while, swaying to the faraway music lovers alone always seem to fabricate together. It took a few bars, but eventually her movements grew slower, more languorous, her sighs longer and sweeter, curling in the air, setting everything alight with possibility the way she always did. All the tensions of the week, of his whole life, falling away. He ran his hand up her hip, onto her waist.
So maybe we could...
But Mr. Blake, there are important guests upstairs. She murmured. Think about your reputation if we were caught.
It'd improve.
Uh-huh. Take it easy, sailor. She squeezed his hand.
Okay. Maybe we'll just hang a bit.
Holding her close again, he looked around and inspected the unfinished loft more intently. Wondered how many more years it would be before he could afford such a place. To be able to give Mary Rose something like this. By 45, he decided. A little more than 10 years. It was entirely up to him.
You know, he said, I think I prefer it down here, too.
No fair teasing.
Seriously. Look, you can see everything better.
He pointed outside, and she turned back to look out the window with him, across the river.
There's St. Gertrude's, see the steeple. Got my ass kicked on the church basketball court. That scar on my lip you think is so cute? Tommy Watson. Could see my teeth with my mouth closed. And there, all the trees. That's King's Essing Park. Billy Spinelli fell off the gazebo roof there one night and broke his back. When it happened, he couldn't stop laughing.
Your stories of youth are always so horrid.
Okay, then how about this? So, there's King's Essing Park. I saw John Legend play a free concert there when he was still in college.
And he was brilliant. She'd pulled his arms more tightly around her, somehow enfolding herself in his memories. And you had fun.
You know, I don't remember. I was, like, 14, there to drink lousy beer and hit on lousier girls. I probably had fun.
Ah, the perfect scoundrel.
I like it when you say things like that. Feels like I'm dating Queen Elizabeth.
The first, I hope. She turned again completely in his arms, staring up at him. Do you miss it?
Not really. Had to grow up somewhere.
He looked over her, and across the Black River, across all the years between there and tonight.
Learned a lot.
She grimaced. Tonight, I fear, you've learned only that you're dating a weirdo.
Learn that long before tonight, love. Besides, that's how I like 'em.
I'm sorry. I wanted us...
Enough already.
He'd taken her hand.
Terminamos. Apologize again and all.
You'll what?
I'll think of something.
Mary Rose leaned up to kiss his neck. Why'd you put up with me?
Because I love you.
She smiled. How do you know?
Come on.
He held out both hands, shrugging.
Doubt thou the stars of fire.
I may swoon. Seriously, how do you know?
Seriously? Jesus, Mary Rose, I just do. I don't know. Same way I know when I'm gonna win a case. You just... Okay. Here's how I know. Every time I see you, I... Well...
I still basically feel like I've been punched in the stomach.
She laughed. That sounds dreadful. Or delightfully cliché.
Sorry, I'm not very hallmark, but that's what came to mind.
He grinned down at her, put his hands on her hips again.
See, I'm the weirdo.
She reached up to flatten a tuft of his hair. What am I going to do with you?
Just love me back, and let's get out of here. Call it a night.
But Keith and...
Keith's focusing on making the nightly news. Come on.
He stepped from the window and pulled her by the hand.
Let's get you home.
Yes, Mary Rose said, glancing back toward the window. Home. Two. Home. A simple word. One syllable. Four little letters. A word toddlers used. And yet it conjured a thousand different meanings. Emotions. Memories. How many had come to her these last weeks and minutes? Too many to count. How many more would come 4 days from now, after they'd actually arrived? She feared to even imagine an answer. Mary Rose half-closed her laptop, crossed her hands atop the screen, and leaned forward to lay her chin there. Beyond was a short bank, and then the Delaware River, passing in long meandering ribbons of slate blue and grey, as ducks bobbed peacefully along its shore. She loved it here, the perfect place to work, to draw, to think. Farther downriver, several men sat in lawn chairs or on upside-down buckets, fishing from the riverside. Two women glided past together on kayaks, and her gaze and thoughts drifted beside their black, sinuous wakes. It had already been more than 5 years since she'd been home, almost 7 years, actually. Could it truly have been so long? No, that was impossible. Any time she'd been off to one boarding school or another or some college, she'd somehow always returned again in months, inexplicably drawn back to a place where she'd always felt like an outsider, an imposter. Finally escaping to America had been the longest she'd managed to keep away, and she now felt like a recovered alcoholic considering one more drink after so many years of sobriety. Mary Rose tried evoking all that time passing, hoping to create a montage of such milestones and memories, things she'd done, all the remarkable people she'd met, places visited and so forth, but nothing came to mind. Throwing herself completely at her grades first, then her work, at getting A's and scholarships, at finishing projects and keeping clients happy. Most all day, 7 days a week, and she'd gotten all the A's and more clients, yes, but the residual consequence was that 7 years had seemingly passed in minutes, been nicked from her without her even knowing it had happened. She almost feared blinking and waking up in her late 40s. The age her parents had been when she'd last been home. How different would they look now? She'd seen them since, of course, during their visits to the States, but that was not the same at all. She tried envisioning them taking breakfast together in the back patio, or moving through the house's dim hallways, or asleep at night in their rooms. What new art had her father acquired? What new flowers to be found, if any, in Mother's back garden? Or were they and the house the same as she left it 7 years before? A dollhouse waiting for her eventual return? How haughty to believe so. Yet that's what she believed entirely. The house would be exactly the same, and so would they. And so, she dreaded, will I? No, not possible. She concentrated harder to come up with something tangible to prove she'd grown beyond her long-ago self. If not specific memories, then at least a personal resume she could cling to beyond the grades and accounts. She'd earned 2 degrees in art, worked for a top agency, made diverse American friends, vacationed in Mexico, volunteered at community arts programs, bought her own condo, ran a bloody half marathon, gone freelance, and fallen in love with Simon. Simon. Beautiful Simon. Mary Rose allowed her lips to curve into a smile, tilted her head, her thoughts turning from the shadows of the past to the mirror-bright possibilities of her future. She would marry Simon. Yes. And in 4, maybe 5 days, he would ask her parents for her hand, or rather for their blessing. An outdated custom, surely even offensive to many these days, but she didn't care one bit. It somehow made all of it seem more like something from a fairy tale. She closed her eyes and felt the early September sun warm against her face. not perhaps the best idea to work by the river today. The metaphor too exact, her mind too easily carried downstream into the bay, and then out to the ocean, and yes, back home again. Mary Rose leaned back and set her laptop aside. If she could get at least one assignment delivered, the rough sketches for the new vodka company logo, perhaps, the revised treatment of the cranberry juice carton, she could call today a success with a straight face. She retrieved her sketchbook and began working again, each swipe of her pen, each decision, slower than the last. But 20 minutes later, she'd managed to force out 2 genuine possibilities for the logo. Maybe. She drew a line through the first image. 1 genuine possibility now.
"Well, aren't you the sweetest thing?"
Mary Rose turned to the voice. An older woman stood behind her, early 80s at least, entirely frozen, but no more than 10 feet away, hovering almost. Her grey hair buzzed close and tight. Only the dark shawl across her back fluttered behind her in a lifting breeze.
"Like a little angel,"
the woman added. Mary Rose glanced around to see who the woman was talking to, realized it could only be her. "Good afternoon," she said to her. "Isn't it a gorgeous day?" The woman now tottered forward, each step cautious and labored. She muttered as she walked, eventually reaching Mary Rose's bench. She laid a hand on its curved metal back and asked,
"What you working on?"
Her voice held a gentle, childlike quality. Closer, Mary Rose saw the near-hollow look in the woman's brown eyes. Homeless? No, the clothes were meticulous. The onset of some form of dementia, for sure. "Oh, nothing." Mary Rose looked again to see where she'd come from. "Just something for... it's nothing."
"Can I see?" asked the woman.
Mary Rose held out the book with the picture she'd been drawing, a rough abstract of a woman's calf, ankles, and high-heeled shoes, ending in the top of a bottle.
"Oh, that's a nice one," the woman said, smiling. "You're gonna be an artist, I bet."
"Well, as a matter of fact, that's what I am." Mary Rose closed the book and smiled broadly. The woman studied her, silent, confused.
"Where are your mamma at?"
she asked suddenly. Mary Rose blinked.
"Your mother."
"Okay. Probably in her garden, I suspect. I'm afraid she lives far away now. In England, actually. But funny you should mention her. I'll be seeing her in a few days now."
"You going to England?"
"Yes, ma'am."
"Who take care of you?"
the woman asked, paused, her muted eyes going wide.
"You playing with that boy? I've seen him before, but never you. Who you staying with?"
"I'm sorry." Mary Rose couldn't follow. "I'm not sure what you mean." The woman stared ahead.
"The white boy,"
she explained, flapping a craggy dark hand. Mary Rose followed her gaze, saw nothing, only the river, pleated in inky and dimming furrows.
"His mama. She did the bad thing. How come you..."
"Dina!"
A man's voice interrupted whatever the woman might have said next. He jogged up toward them from the path, hustling behind the benches.
"I'm so sorry,"
he said quickly to Mary Rose. Good, she thought. Someone who could take her away. As soon as she thought it, shame snapped through her, and she smiled brightly to dispel her uneasiness, the strange touch of melancholy that limned the golden air with the coolest shades of fall. "Not at all," she offered. "We were just talking." He took the old woman's arm.
"Aunt Dina, you had me scared half to death."
"Oh, Jalen,"
she turned to him.
"Isn't she the sweetest thing?"
"Oh, yes, ma'am,"
he said, mouthed the word sorry again. Mary Rose lifted a hand. "It was very nice meeting you, Dina," she said.
"And so polite."
The woman waved back at her.
"You be careful now, darling."
"Enjoy your day," she said to them both. The man turned his aunt and started leading her back toward the path.
"Thanks,"
he said, looking back, his relief mirroring her own. Mary Rose waved civilly and watched them go, then returned her gaze back to the river, and thought about what the woman had said, but not for long. She'd reopened her sketchbook to get working again, to get something down, anything. This logo wouldn't create itself. A half hour later, she'd filled several pages, and when she saw what she'd drawn, she blinked, tore out and then folded the pages over, then over again, then a third time, boxing and pressing, flattening and forgetting. What a silly thing to have drawn. Irritated, Mary Rose refocused on the Delaware, her mind skittering over the buildings, the water, the slow, indolent current. Farther downriver, the summer before, a mother had plunged with her infant into the water. She'd wrapped bricks to his chest, the tape going around and around. Neither of them had survived. A little white boy, she remembered now. Words from her childhood, a silly song, again came to mind. They wrap you up in a big white sheet and cover you from head to feet. They put you in a big black box and cover you with dirt and rocks. Mary Rose straightened carefully on the bench, started to collect her belongings. Perhaps this wasn't the best place to work after all. Perhaps many things. 3. At Heathrow, Simon rented a Mercedes-Benz for the week, for less than a Maxima would have cost back in the States. Remarkable, 550 horsepower, pearl white, immaculate. He'd met Mary Rose's parents only twice before, lunch in Philadelphia and an afternoon spent in New Hope, and, considering his intentions, it was important he secure a more permanent and inspiring impression this visit. He hoped the car would help. Something had to, because the closer they got to her childhood home, the tenser he'd become. Nervous, almost. Surprisingly so. He wasn't one to easily shaken. At first, he'd simply written off the clenched fingers around the steering wheel to the strangeness of driving on the wrong side of the road, but each mile closer to Alderley Edge, he'd grown more anxious. While the reaction had been disconcerting, he'd sorted it out well enough. It was, after all, the first and last time he'd asked someone for their daughter's hand in marriage. Mary Rose stared out the window beside him, head resting against the glass. She'd been quiet for almost the entire trip, lost to her own thoughts, memories, and sentiments, unshared though they were, of seeing her parents. Perhaps he was just feeding off her overstimulated energy.
"Strange being back,"
he asked to break the silence, to focus their now shared angst. "I suppose. I don't know what to feel.
Yes.
He studied the next highway sign. "It's almost as if I've never left." Simon smiled.
"I think that sometimes when I'm back in South Philly, maybe more than sometimes, that all that time, all those years past, mean very little."
She murmured in agreement, closed her eyes again. An hour later, he'd pulled off the main road and was working his way through the southern half of Alderley Edge. A lot of cafes and high-end designer shops. Mary Rose awake once more, watching them pass.
"That's Congleton, yes?"
He squinted at the street sign ahead. "Yes," she replied quietly. "Just down the road now." He followed the street past mostly hidden residences, lost behind lush tree lines and privacy fences of stone and or iron. The few glimpses he'd gathered suggested homes starting in the low millions, though several were easily eight-figure estates. He kept his surprise to himself. He'd always suspected Mary Rose had come from money, the way she carried herself, the way she paid no attention to its necessity, but he hadn't really given much thought to her parents' wealth. Her father was a retired magistrate in his mid-50s, taught a single course at a local university, but he didn't know much about the family beyond that.
"Macclesfield Road,"
he announced, turning the car, as Mary Rose perched more in her seat, focused on the properties they passed. A stone wall about 4 feet high ran the length of the next property. The GPS on the dashboard flashed arrival, and Simon slowed the car to a crawl, as he scanned the stone wall and its open gate for an address of some kind.
"This is it, yes?"
Mary Rose nodded, the joy on her face indisputable as he pulled slowly into the narrow opening and proceeded up to the house. An enormous Tudor, with several steeply pitched roofs and prominent cross gables, stood majestically on manicured grounds, half stone with gingerbread timbering and shakes weathered to a mellow grey. A luxurious black shadow stretched from the house, and verdant lush ivy ran across most of the front yard like an ocean, creeping up to the porch and over its railings. A fountain was surrounded by neatly cropped bushes that formed a low wall in the centre of the wide paved driveway. Larger bushes, equally trimmed into a natural wall,
blocked the back lawn. He remembered Mary Rose saying something about it being some sort of gentleman's club more than a century before, the home where various local judges and doctors, admired politicians and professors, gathered to drink, smoke cigars, and trade in fossils and exotic pornography amid enthralled discussions of everything from world exploration and science to prostitution and cannibalism. The left corner of the house was all stone, a three-story tower, the time-eaten rock patched unevenly with black ivy and dripstone concretion. Its few windows were bare slits of dull light, framed in thick lumber that pocked the sides of the mansion like narrow ebony scars. Simon drove to the top of the driveway, breathed out deeply.
"We made it,"
he smiled, turning. But Mary Rose was already half out of the car, springing from her seat and leaving the door swinging open behind. Simon sat dumbfounded and watched her bound up the steps to the double doors.
"Okay,"
he drawled to himself as she vanished into the home. He climbed from the car, stretched his back, and took several more deep breaths, looking over the property and house. In one of the windows above, a dark figure stood to the side, half lost behind obscure reflections in the glass. Simon squinted up into the sun peeking over the house, gave a chest-high wave of hello to whichever parent it was. Deciding to save their bags for later, he followed slowly after Mary Rose while crunching up the gravel path and onto the broad porch steps. Mary Rose had left one of the double doors wide open, and Simon stepped within. He shivered, his first thought that the old house was unusually cold. Then again, everywhere in England felt cold to him. His next thought was that his future in-law's home, for all its external grandeur, was cluttered and somewhat, if being polite, out of date. The walls panelled in dark walnut, the entry hall crowded on either side with huge antique furniture, a pair of marble statues on pedestals, and the high-backed chairs with burgundy velvet lining. Cascading rows of dark-coloured paintings and black-and-white photographs. A curved staircase led up into shadow, where a second-floor corridor overlooked the entryway. Above it all, an ornate chandelier and a panelled ceiling crisscrossed in late afternoon sunlight. Closer, most of the paintings turned out to be portraits. Family members, he assumed from the clothing, mutton chops and sour expressions, from another century ago or more. One, clearly a newer painting, was of an attractive and refined woman, who looked like Mary Rose might look in another 20 years. The mother, Francine Moreland. Certainly one of the colder fishes he'd yet run into in this world. Farther down, a painting of Mary Rose herself, mid to late teens, he assumed, seated before a window but turned sideways and looking back at the artist, her delicate hands folded neatly in her lap, eyes wide and almost surprised at the intrusion, challenging. Simon smiled. It was a look he knew well. He passed the other photos and paintings, the eyes of young Mary Rose and several generations of her bloodline following each step, and chased after the warm low voices in the next room, beyond where the hall opened to an adjoining sitting room, or, he now saw fully, a study. At the end of the hall, something glinted back at him from the shadows.
"Ah, here's our lad now."
Mary Rose's father, standing at a table beside another man, waved Simon into the study.
"Welcome, welcome,"
he greeted warmly. Simon crossed the room to shake hands.
"James," he said, carefully using her father's Christian name.
Mr. Moreland was respectful, but somehow seemed too boyish for the business at hand this visit. Besides, her father had several times before corrected him, asking to be called James. Her father was taller than Simon remembered, and thinner too, his cheeks hollow, his hair a thatch of brown turning silver. His body gave the unsettling impression of being at war with itself, his lips dipping down at the edges, even as he smiled broadly at Simon. His head canted and shoulders sloped as if to make up for his height, the thick sweater a bit too heavy on his thin frame, his stylish trousers baggy. Even his voice boomed too loud in the quiet room, a man most comfortable being at odds.
"A pleasant trip, she told us,"
he said, his eyes as grey as the shakes on the house.
"Oh, yes."
Simon turned about the room, looking for Mary Rose.
"Already dashed out to the back garden to fetch Franny. The dear girl burst in like a cyclone. Simon Blake."
Moreland turned.
"This is George Amy, a local busybody and a family friend for 100 years.
Simon smiled,
shook hands with the other man. Unlike Moreland, Amy was what he expected in a northern Englishman, sturdy, red-faced, and wrapped in tweed, and older, early 60s, he supposed.
"Pleasure," he said.
"How are you holding up in the colonies these days?"
Mr. Amy asked, his voice strained, his playful remark a mere feign at levity. Simon shrugged, playing back the humour carefully.
"I'm from Philly and can see Independence Hall from my office window. We're hanging in there as always before, sir."
Mr. Amy grunted, then turned and winked at Moreland, who chuckled curtly. Meanwhile, Simon noticed, the man had started edging away, making his exit.
"Well, I best believe in you all now,"
he said, confirming Simon's read.
"You'll be wanting to catch up and—" "Nonsense,"
Moreland huffed.
"You only got here, and Mary Rose hasn't seen you in 10 years or more." "Yes, well—"
Mr. Amy looked out into the hall and toward the front door, planning more than an exit, more of an escape.
"I'll unearth the time later this week for a proper visit. You should be allowed more privacy to suitably welcome your guests. First, perhaps, we resolve this matter of the art you've brought me."
Moreland turned to Simon, smiling. He'd stepped back to the table.
"You're not going to forget and leave it here, are you?"
"James,"
Mr. Amy shook his head crossly, "you're a shameful—" "Do you know much about collectible art, Simon?"
Moreland asked.
"No, sir. Despite the efforts of Mary Rose and our trips to many museums. Still working on the difference between Renoir and Seuss, I'm afraid."
Moreland chuckled.
"I suspect otherwise. She was always—"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.